Like a chrysalis, we're emerging from the economy of the Industrial Revolution. An economy confined to and limited by the Earth's physical resources, into the economy in mind, in which there are no bounds on human imagination, and the freedom to create is the most precious natural resource.
Welcome to the Soul of Enterprise, Business, and the Knowledge Economy, sponsored by Sage, building experiences that connect, remove friction, and deliver insights. I'm Ron Baker, along with my good friend and VeriSage Institute colleague, Ed Kless. On today's show, folks, we're going to go through systems thinking made simpler. Hey, Ed, how's it going?
I thought it was made easy, Ron, but you're just you're saying simpler now.
Simpler,
okay, because I think we're walking it back a little bit. We're walking it back a little bit.
This is actually based on a book called Simple Complexity, a management book for the rest of us, a guide to systems thinking, by William Donaldson, PhD, published in 2017. Shout out to Mark Gandy on his book on his CFO Bookshelf show, which he did with the author on April 30th, 2023. And that is just one of those podcasts I listened to and said, this guy has got such a refreshing take on systems thinking that it made sense to me. And I just thought it would be worth doing a show on, because I know we've tackled this topic before. I forget the show number.
Way back, long time ago.
But we use Peter Senge's book, The Fifth Discipline.
Yes.
And that's not an easy book to get through.
No.
And he lays out 11 laws in that book that we did get through and we talked about and gave our own examples. But this guy's just got a different take on it. It's not anything new or radical. It's just expressing it, I think, maybe in a more digestible way.
Well, the bar was not high. Or the bar was pretty low, I should say.
True.
The bar was pretty low for express. I mean, look, don't get me wrong. Senge's work is some of the seminal stuff in this area. The fifth discipline was a major influence over me, especially back in the days when I was building a partner organization where we were going in and replacing people's accounting system and sometimes entire back office and even front office operations. So you needed some of those foundational principles to be able to do this. And just the concept of what he calls the learning organization, which is right up our alley, you know, the knowledge mm-hmm. economy. If wealth is knowledge, learning is growth. So what is it that we're doing to create an organization that learns collectively? And this is why we're in love with after action reviews and all of this stuff. But Senge's stuff is great, but man, it's hard to get through. It's hard to get through.
And of course, there's some other, really prominent lights in this field, Peter Drucker being among them.
Oh, of course. Yeah.
Margaret Wheatley is another one.
Mm-hmm.
Donella Meadows, W. Edwards Deming, and one of my favorite, who I just stumbled on, I don't know, 10 years ago, Russell Ackoff. But there are a lot of others, and he cites most of them. But I just thought it would be an interesting show to kind of go through this, because this topic just is overlooked, especially in the leadership literature.
I agree.
We can come in and just do this and just ignore or just be oblivious of the fact that this whole thing is a system.
Mm-hmm.
He starts with a great quote from Tom Northup, and he says, "All organizations are perfectly designed to get the results they are now getting." And that's a brutally true fact. I mean, it's just, you know, hey, look, the system's got its own rhythm and cadences, mm-hmm. and systems bite back. They're both complex and simple, and you have to behold them, and you have to beware of them.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you introduce something that they don't like, you're gonna get the result or not mm-hmm. get the result. So I really like this, but let's start where we usually do. Let's describe this. He says, okay, your enterprise is a system that converts inputs, time, people, and money,
mm-hmm.
into outputs, goods and services, what systems thinkers call throughputs. And he says, ask yourself, are those results acceptable and desired? Did you design the system? or did it develop by default? Because it will develop by default. And as the owner or leader, you are the designer of your organization. So I kind of like that. Then he goes on to say, Ed, that systems thinking derives its power from the philosophic concept of holism. And holism is the theory that the parts cannot exist independent of the whole. You cannot understand the parts without understanding the whole, and understand that the whole is greater than the sum of the parts. You must combat the reductionist tendency to look at your enterprise as a set of discrete parts to be optimized.
Yeah. I mean, this is the famous Homer Simpson video that we've played for years, where, you know, Homer's asked to, Danny DeVito plays the car owner, right? And they design the car, and Homer puts all of these different disparate things together. It seems like a great idea, and it's an absolute disaster. But you're right on with this. And you know what's interesting is that the word that is used to describe that holism, when I first started learning this, was integrity.
Mm. Mm. Mm-hmm.
And it's still used that way in the UK and Australia. The word integrity means slightly different things in North America than it does in UK, right, and other English speaking countries. 'Cause that integrity has this holistic concept to it. It integral, like a whole number, right? So that's the same thing. And sometimes I like thinking of using that word instead of holism, because I think that gets a little bit
airy fairy.
Yeah. And this is might just be the way my brain and my system works, but the integrity really helps me encapsulate that a little bit better.
Yeah, no, it's a great point. I mean, yeah, we talk about the integrity of the system, right?
Mm-hmm. Right.
Russell Ackoff, in his book Creating the Corporate Future from 1981, he defined it this way. He said a system is a whole that cannot be divided into independent parts. Its properties and behavior derive from the interactions of its parts, not their actions considered separately. A disassembled auto cannot carry people.
Nope. and Ron, I'm curious to something as we're talking through this. One of the things I think that I saw you have, not necessarily an epiphany, but more of a realization, even after the two of us met, was that pricing was, and value pricing was affected by this. Because I don't know if you had taught it this way, but maybe when you wrote the original Professional's Guide to Value Pricing, you were more thinking along the lines as well, I'll just take the billable hour and cost plus pricing and replace it with value pricing. And it, you know, as take this out, put this in. And I think one of the realizations that I think you have had over time, and it's been greater and greater, is that changes everything, and you can't just change that one piece of the system.
That dawned on me very, very slowly as I worked through that first book and its first six editions, that you weren't just tampering with pricing. You were, Reed Holden and his group, Tom Nagel and others in that group taught me this. You touch pricing, you touch everything. It touches everything. And, you know, but that's just systems thinking.
You touch anything, it touches everything.
You touch marketing, you touch finance, you touch any silo. And right, it's going to have repercussions. But yeah, definitely. This is why Paul O'Byrne, the late Paul O'Byrne, used to tell me, he said, you don't say it this way, but you should. He said, value pricing is a panacea. And I think it took me a while to figure out what he meant, but because it changes, it forces you to change everything as you're touching the system. That's why I can't just get on board with people that say, oh, you can value price but still keep timesheets. No, timesheets are a system. they're incongruent. Mutually exclusive. It hurts your integrity.
Right.
You know, because it's just not congruent with the rest of the system. So yeah, I think that's very true. And of course, especially after reading a lot of Drucker and Ackoff and some of these others, Margaret Wheatley, you realize that, oh, geez, we're all in a system, whether we like it or not, whether we acknowledge it, whether we're conscious of it or not. And right. Ed, I think most people are unconscious about it. I really do.
Oh, absolutely. And we're all parts of systems in different places that we don't realize that we're a part of. This is not just at the office, right? You, in a way, your family unit is a system. And this gets back to Howard Hansen's work too, in triangles and all kinds of emotional connection. But I want to ask you, going back now, did you, as you were putting together Time's Up, your new book, and by the way, quick pitch for Time's Up Club. Those of you who are listening and not a member of Time's Up Club, go out to timesupclub.com and make sure you join the Free Forever program. We can get the chapter summaries from audio chapter summaries from Ron's book. But did that influence having realized that from a systems thinking perspective with value pricing, how did it affect your conception and creation of Time's Up?
Boy, I think it forced both of us to reevaluate. The three of us, let's say.
Yeah.
It forced all of us to rethink everything. Mm-hmm. You had to rethink certain tenets of value pricing. Hey, you don't need three choices. Hey, we shouldn't be talking about scope. It forced a rethinking, and that we're not there yet with this guy's book, but we're going to get there, where he talks about how a culture emerges and what it emerges from the system. But we're still kind of not done with the definition.
Yeah,
but,
sorry. But
that's fine. That's something that we can go to. I just want to touch off one thing. He also says, and I just love this because this is a great duality and just, you know, that idea of what's that famous quote of holding two incongruent ideas in your head at the same time and being able to function.
Yeah.
Systems are both simple and complex. And you have to embrace both states. He said, business is taught in a reductionist way. You know, we break the complex organization into pieces, right? Marketing, accounting, finance. But it's modeled on the Newtonian and mechanical principles, presumes that if we study all the parts individually, we will understand the whole. Yet each of these functions are all subordinate to the enterprise system. They are each a system within a larger system. And I'm trying to optimize each one of them is often counterproductive. So kind of like, that's another great point.
Yeah.
They're both simple and complex, and that's going to repeat over and over as we talk about this.
And, you know, Margaret Wheatley, you brought her up earlier, she was on show number 308, by the way, that one of the things I learned from her, and I remember reading this passage in the book, and one of her books is called Leadership and the New Science. Mm-hmm. Where she makes this direct comparison to this notion that, okay, we have this Newtonian view of things, but physics has gone beyond that. And it's now more about the stuff that we don't understand, things like quantum entanglement, quantum theory. And what we really have to do is rethink our businesses in terms of those kinds of structures. The very simple way that she phrases it, which I thought was great, which she says, on your organization chart, it's more about the lines than it is the boxes.
The boxes, yeah. Yeah, that's a great, this guy gets into that too. That's fantastic. I've always liked Jonah's analogy of the difference between and I think it goes back to Hayek. Don't try and be like an engineer, be more like a gardener.
Yeah.
Cultivate the conditions for growth, but don't try and, you know, organize it. Anyway, Ed, this is flying by. And folks, we'd like to remind you, if you want to contact Ed or me, send us an email to asktsoe@verisage.com. Do check out our Patreon channel, where you can get access to our bonus show and commercial-free regular show. That's at patreon.com/TSOE. That channel is sponsored by 90 Minds. It's a matter of mind. Check them out at 90minds.com. And now a word from our sponsors.
Follow Voice America at facebook.com/Voice America for juicy updates from your favorite radio shows and podcasts.
Have you ever read a book that changed your life? I sure have. Have you ever listened to an advertisement for a book so many times that you question the existence of God? Me too. Hello, I'm Greg Kite. I recorded the advertisement for Ron and Ed's book, The Soul of Enterprise, Dialogues on Blah, 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 Whatever. And 4 years later, we're all tired of it, especially me. But thankfully, there's a solution. For just $10 a month, you never have to hear my voice again. For a commercial-free version of The Soul of Enterprise, go to patreon.com/TSOE and subscribe now.
Sage provides accountants with compliance, reporting, and analytic solutions to do more for their clients. These solutions include education programs such as the Sage Accountants Network Client Advisory Service Program. This program delivers the tools to create, package, price, market, and deliver additional services to clients, increasing your profitability and delivering more value to your clients. Let Sage help you grow your business by visiting sageaccountantsnetwork.com.
Voice America is on LinkedIn. Connect with us today.
You are tuned into The Soul of Enterprise with Ron Baker and Ed Kless. To find out more about our show, visit us on the web at thesoulofenterprise.com. You can also chat with us on Twitter using hashtag AskTSOE. Now, back to The Soul of Enterprise.
Welcome back, everybody. We're trying to make systems thinking easier. and Ed, one of the things I really liked is he's got throughout the book, he's got these bold words, behold and beware. Behold the system. It's got amazing constructs at which one often must marvel. I think this is how we feel about the price system, right? Mm-hmm. Behold it and marvel. But then beware of the system, because systems have a mind and rhythm of their own. And they're often vexing. This is why Peter Senge called systems thinking the fifth discipline, because it is the discipline that integrates the disciplines.
Mm-hmm.
That's another interesting thing to talk about. And he also points out that perhaps the single greatest liability of management is they confront these complex, dynamic realities with a language designed for simple, static problems. I just can't help thinking of macroeconomics when I hear that. The mm-hmm. Fed going, oh, we're going to do this. We're going to move this lever, and it's going to have this effect on the economy. Are you kidding me?
Mm-hmm.
You know, when you're talking about a system as complex as the economy.
Well, and let's talk about this a little bit at the risk of, you know, getting everybody to get to a snooze fest, because as soon as we bring up economics, Ron, you know that there's a certain percentage of people like, okay, it's time to take a little nap. But, you know, I still am trying to completely unpack in my mind the great quote from Hayek about the curious task of economics is to demonstrate to men how little they really know about what they imagine they can design. And that it's so hard to unpack that. But the more and more I've thought about it, the more and more I seem to be coming to the conclusion that I thought it was about that when he said that, well, how little they know about how much they can design was that we have great power with us to be able to do stuff to it. But it's not. It's actually a little bit of the inverse of that. It's saying, you think you can design this? You can't.
Right.
This emerge. It's a cautionary quote. Is you can't design it. It has to emerge a little bit more. And I like to. Does the book make any call? Because I think you brought it up a little bit earlier of emergent systems versus design systems, as to whether one is better or superior than the other, or does he say they can be designed, but they're still going to emerge? There's still going to be an organic function around it that even if you try to design it, it's going to go its own way.
Yeah, he doesn't talk about it that way like we're used to hearing, you know, mm-hmm. Russ Roberts talk about emergent systems and mm-hmm. that type of thing and spontaneous order and all that. But he does talk about the three essential components of a system. They're based on elements, mm-hmm. elements within the system, the interactions, right? And this is basically the design of the work, how people interact and get things done. Mm-hmm. So elements, interactions, and purpose. He said a system needs a purpose. Without a purpose, what's the point of bringing the elements together, mm-hmm. right? A watch tells time. That's a function, but the person wearing it has a purpose, right, to be somewhere on time. And I think this is one of the really cool things about this. He said, beware, the system will reveal the true purpose in spite of the stated vision and mission statements or the absence thereof. And beware and behold, And I love this, Ed, your corporate culture is an emergent property of your system.
Yes.
Culture is a component of your system, one that you cannot address directly because it emerges from the system. So we've talked about this all the time. You want to work on your culture, you have to work on those interactions, those elements, or your purpose, right? Because this is I think the problem with keeping the timesheet in a value pricing firm. It doesn't make sense with the interactions and the purpose overall.
No.
Of having a pricing culture versus, have a measurement culture like that.
Yeah. And in fact, it's contradictory to it. And I'll give you another, well, I know you know this, but I want to share this with our audience. And we have talked about this recently. So it is Ricardo Semler's idea about getting rid of expense reports.
Right.
Right. Because, and if you really think about that, I just love that this whole concept is that when Ricardo Semler is the head of Semco down in Brazil, and their policy is that everyone who comes to work for Semco is given an American Express card the day that they start with the organization and told, if you need anything to do your job better, put it on the American Express card. We don't audit it. We just pay it, right? I'm sure they categorize it, whatever, for the correct expense line item in the, in the P&L, but they're not going to look at it. They're just going to pay it. Because if you need to do something, take it and do it. And I just there's so many things about this, but not the least of which is that's trust. We hear organizations pay lip service to we have a high level of trust inside our organizations, and then you ask, do you have an expense reporting system? And they say yes. And I'm like, why?
Yeah, with 14 layers of approval.
Well, not even 14. Just the fact that you have an expense system that has an approval process is counter to trust. Because what it's saying is, no, we don't trust you to do what's right with this card, and we need to make sure that your expenses are in alignment and are okay. We need to check you. We don't trust you. We don't trust that you won't be a fiduciary responsible person in the organization. And you say, well, if you gave them that, they would just really, they're going to buy all of their meals on the American Express card. Then why did you hire that person? If you think that that's what somebody's going to do, coupled with the fact that and this is the thing I love about Semler, he says most of the people that we give American Express cards to are in some way customer facing. And they could do millions of dollars of damage to relationships by saying something, doing something stupid, but I'm not going to trust them with an expense an expense account and an American Express card. This is insane. So you see, and that's what I love this point that he's making in this book. It is completely counterproductive. It says, oh, we high level of trust in our culture, but here's the expense system.
Right. It's almost like he doesn't say this directly, but I kind of implied this from the book. From the system emerges the reality.
Hmm.
We can have purpose on the wall. We can run around and say this and that, but man, the system, you want to learn what's going on?
Mm-hmm.
Get the feedback from the system. Just like they say, talk to the frontline workers, right, in an organization to learn really what's going on. Right. That's why CEOs go on listening tours when they start, because they're not talking to the C-suite. They're talking to the people on the front line.
Mm-hmm.
I just read the book by the CEO took over United Airlines. One of the flight attendants came up to him on a flight. It was like his first week or something. And he was on this big listening tour, and she came up to him. And she goes, stop making me have to say I'm sorry to the passengers. And that stuck with him, and it became the theme of his turnaround. Ed, I've been flying United. I didn't even know there was a turnaround. I didn't expect, but apparently there was major headaches because of the Continental merger.
Oh, right.
They couldn't fly on the same planes. They had all these crazy union rules. But anyway, that system emerged, and he really tried to push it back and work on it, and he ended up doing quite well with it. This guy also points out, Donaldson points out, there are no separate systems. The system is always connected. It's never severable. The system itself does not recognize boundaries. Only we do. This is what Herman Simon, Herbert Simon, sorry, meant by bounded rationality. That refers to the tendency for people within the system to behave as if the boundaries are real. Like the dog thinking the electric fence is a real boundary. People will begin to maximize the interactions within their boundaries, but it could be detrimental to the system as a whole. I just read a thing in Bartleby where managers hoard the best workers for their, you know, everybody wants the best workers, right? Well, think about how detrimental that is to a system. Sure, that's maximizing their silo or their team or whatever, but is it optimizing the entire system? Of course not. And that's going to have shocks throughout this. That's going to cause shockwaves throughout the system when you just do a move like that.
Yeah. There's a story. I don't know if it's apocryphal or based on some scientific research that was actually done, but it was, I think, in the 30s with a set of monkeys. And I believe it was something like that. There was a ladder with bananas at the top of this cage.
Yes.
And whenever a monkey would try to step up the ladder, they would spray water cannons at the other monkeys. So what the other monkeys would do is they would go and they would try to get somebody off the ladder. They would get the other monkey off the ladder, right? And it got to the point where they were able to introduce a new monkey like each time. And at a certain point, what they were able to do is just they didn't even have to spray the water cannon anymore.
Right.
Just
right.
Whenever one of the monkey tried to get up on the ladder, the other would attack it and rip it down.
Right. There was a guy up in Canada who used that video and he equated it to hourly billing. He did it in a very creative way. Do you remember that? It was years ago, but
okay.
You know, we talked about that. This guy also talks about the concept of systematicity, which is, you know, the inescapable connection to the larger system. He's got all these really cool words, but there is another concept that, and we'll talk about this after the break, that I really like. First off, all systems require feedback loops, right? Critical to the proper functioning. This is why I think AARs are so vital. But he also talks about, he doesn't call it a bar, a before action review, but that's kind of what he's proposing in replace of the annual performance appraisal. He hates annual performance appraisals as much as we do because the feedback loop is too long. You just can't wait and do this once a year. And like he said, you know, participants in the system often see or sense the real feedback. But the thing that the example I love most in the book is his concept of the hermeneutic circle. The hermeneutic circle. And we're going to talk about that next, Ed, after the break. So folks, I want to remind you, if you want to get a hold of me or Ed, send us an email to asktsoe@verisage.com. Check us out at soulofenterprise.com. We'll post full show notes. And also, I'd like to give a shout out to Mark Gandy of cfobookshelf.com, where we got this idea to go over this book. Thank you, Mark. And check Mark's show and podcast out at cfobookshelf.com. And now a word from our sponsors.
Enjoying our shows and can't get enough of us? Follow us on Instagram at Voice America Talk Radio and see what we're cooking up for you.
Sage provides accountants with compliance, reporting, and analytic solutions to do more for their clients. These solutions include education programs such as the Sage Accountants Network Client Advisory Service Program. This program delivers the tools to create, package, price, market, and deliver additional services to clients, increasing your profitability and delivering more value to your clients. Let Sage help you grow your business by visiting sageaccountantsnetwork.com.
Have you ever listened to an online radio show that changed your life? I'm required to say that I have. Have you ever stopped listening to an online radio show because the commercials were mind-numbingly repetitive? Of course you haven't, because you're here right now. Look, you don't have to listen to me anymore. There's a commercial-free version of this show, and it only costs $10 a month. And for $15 a month, you get no commercials. commercials, plus bonus content. Go to patreon.com/TSOE. Subscribe now and be free. You're worth it.
Streaming live, the leader in internet talk radio, VoiceAmerica.com.
You are tuned into The Soul of Enterprise with Ron Baker and Ed Klass. To find out more about our show, visit us on the web at thesoulofenterprise.com. You can also chat with us on Twitter using #AskTSOE. Now, back to The Soul of Enterprise.
And we are back on The Soul of Enterprise. We are talking about systems thinking made simpler or easier. And now, but Ron's throwing words at us like systematicity and hermeneutic circles. Ron, this is not simpler or easier.
Yeah, I go. But this concept is really cool. Hermeneutic circle. So it's a philosophic approach, most often related to legal and religious texts. And reading and absorbing the text in a circular fashion is what it means. Understand the whole to understand the parts, while simultaneously understanding the parts to understand the whole. The example he gives, I just love reading a book that you're only partway through. You have only a vague idea of what the conclusion might be. Until you have completed the book, you are unsure. You have not completed the hermeneutic circle, so the parts are insufficient to give you a concept of the whole. But once you've completed the book, the chapters, characters, plot lines make sense. And of course, each additional reading, you get more nuance and more subtlety.
Mm.
That's the hermeneutic circle. And that's the metaphor he gave. I love that. That's fantastic. And if you think about it, you go into an organization and your team, your department, your silo, whatever. I know it's kind of like the blind men touching the different parts of the elephant, right?
Right. Another classic systems thinking story. Yeah,
exactly. And that's what this is. Until you read the whole book, until you see the whole operation. This is why I think companies that do, you know, cross, I hate to use the word train, but I don't know what else to call it. Cross train people in different, you know, make the baggage handler be a flight attendant and gate agent and all that. It gives you a bigger appreciation for the whole. Mm-hmm. How what I'm doing up here is affect, you know, how what I'm doing above the wing is affecting the people below the wing.
Yeah. And that just that to be, because people get exposed to everything that's going on. And, you know, which is why we suggest that you be very careful when you pick out what you're going to measure in the metrics in your organizations because of the impact on the system's thinking. I mean, you're a great example that you come up. Well, you talk about the airline triple crown, right? Lost luggage, customer complaints, and on-time performance. All of those are great measurements because the most people in the system can affect them.
Right.
They're not siloed metrics.
Not at all. Yeah.
So you have to be careful when you're selecting them that you want to make something. Whereas if you're looking at revenue, well, you know.
Yeah. I just thought that metaphor of reading the book was really good. And then he quotes another guy, Jeff Hawkins, who said this, and this is another one of those deep, profound thoughts. He says, complexity is a symptom of confusion, not a cause.
Say that again. Complexity.
Complexity is a symptom of confusion, not a cause.
Okay. Yep.
So he talks about systems complexify. Sorry, there's another word. They self-evolve into what can seem like unrecognizable messes. And Russell Lakoff says, as managers, we don't solve problems. We manage these messes, right? Because systems seldom present easy solutions. This is why Herbert Simon said we satisfice. Right. Mm-hmm. We do what's satisfactory and sufficient. But in a system, there's always winners and losers. And you must understand and embrace that duality.
Right.
And this is where both and thinking comes from, too, rather than, you know, and or.
Well, yeah. And this goes back to one of the, I mean, we talked about this in the show that we did on systems thinking. And I've talked about this fairly often in my career. But the laws of systems thinking, one of which is that you can have your cake and eat it too, but not at once.
Not at once. Yep.
And that is such an important point, because I, especially with the work that we've done with firms, it is very difficult to change the system that you're in. People think that, oh, we just instantaneously switch over from value from fixed pricing to value pricing or from timesheets. No, it is, it has to be a process, and you can improve two things simultaneously. The classic example of you can have your cake and eat it too, but not at once, is in manufacturing, which is you can't improve the quality of a manufactured good at the same time that you reduce costs.
Right.
Because the improvement of the quality is going to cost you something in the short run. But the hope is that over the long term that reduces costs. But so you know, this is why the thing where that makes me crazy, and we know we need to come up with, Ron, the laws of anti-systems thinking, right? Because one of them is we're going to do less with more.
Yes.
So if any of our listeners out there have examples of these BS anti-systems thinking snippets, I think we could do a show on that. I think that would be fascinating to try to put together some of the business myths that we've destroyed, but more this talk less with more. Come on, give me a break.
Yeah, I even see this, Ed. It really dawned on me too, just watching some of these people talk about technology, and I'm not just talking about AI and ChatGPT, but just any app or that does this, it's going to optimize this, it's going to do. Okay. But this goes back to that fallacy of what's one of the Senge laws about, you know, today's problems are yesterday's solutions. And
yes,
your example is they created spreadsheets, and now we have 52 spreadsheets that don't talk to one another. But isn't the same thing going on every time we introduce a piece of technology? No matter how bright, shiny, and cool it is, it's going to reverberate throughout the system. If the system doesn't like it, it's going to friggin' reject it.
Mm-hmm. And they last forever. And I think I'm gonna bring up here, Ron, this is one of my favorite stories to illustrate that law of systems thinking, which is today's problem come from yesterday's solutions. And this is a fairly famous story. It's been out for quite some time. It's about the story of the space shuttle and the horse's rear end. And this is the way this goes, that the standard railroad gauge is 4 feet, 8.5 inches. Kind of weird. It's because the way they built them in England, and the U.S. railroads were built by English expatriates, right? So the railway lines were the same that people in the pre-world. So why were they this way? Well, because based on the tramways that had jigs and tools, which were based on how the spacing between the wagon wheels, that where people would created ruts in the road. So that's where they put the railroads down, and they put it where the ruts were in the road. And which goes back to the Roman chariots, which had the same wheelbase as the, you know, two horses. And it turns out that one of the specifications for the space shuttle was that their solid rocket boosters, the two rockets on the side, right, had right. to be able to fit on a railroad car. Right. So the whole thing is that the most advanced transportation system ever designed by man was still influenced by the width of a Roman chariot and two horses' asses.
Yeah, I love that. It's a great story. Love that.
Well,
you know, this kind of bleeds into Elihu Goldratt's theory of constraints, right? He was talking about throughput problems, and he said, you know, there's certain parts of the system that limit total system throughput, what he called bottlenecks. No amount of optimization before or after the bottleneck will improve total system throughput as long as the bottleneck remains the limiting factor. This is the fat kid in the Boy Scout troop, right? You're going on the hike. The whole troop is going to be limited by the fat kid. But it's so true, Ed, because we think, we look at that and we go, oh, well, we'll just optimize this and we'll optimize this and the whole system will be better. It doesn't matter. It doesn't work this way. And I think we so miss this. And I see managers miss it. I see leaders miss it.
But, you know, I just want to go back to the Goldratt thing, because there's a great insight in there. And it's if you haven't read the book, I highly recommend it. It's called The Goal. And it's really written in story format, right? Yeah. As an allegory.
It was one of the first.
Yes.
To be written like that.
Yeah, like Patrick Lencioni and his work has kind of come after that. But this notion of it, I think, as I recall, it's been a long time since I read the book, but as I recall, the story is that they had a specific order for some customer that needed to be expedited.
Right.
And they figured out a way to get this expedited. And then someone in a meeting asked a very simple question. If we can do this, expedite it, why can't we always do it?
Do it. Right.
Why can't it always be like this?
Well, you know, Goldratt, again, he was a physicist, and our late colleague, Reginald Lee, got to work with him. But he also said there will always be a constraining part of the system. The bottleneck will merely migrate to another part of the system. So his steps were: find where the system is constrained, the bottleneck, understand the constraint, develop a solution, predict second order system effects, and determine if you can live with those, implement the proposed solution, and then look for where the bottleneck migrated to.
It's like this, you know, you squeeze the balloon, right?
And, you know, as this guy points out, Donaldson, beware, managers begin changing things from a viewpoint bounded by what they see, but it's going to have consequences somewhere else in the system. It has to. It's all connected. This is why we can't just change one part and not expect another part to, you know, to not suffer the consequences. The idea of a system being kind of zero sum is kind of a scary thing, right? That there's always winners and losers.
Yeah, the thing is that leaders behave as if it's not true. Like that's the bizarre part of this, is that they know it. They have to know it because it constantly happens. It's never not happened. But yet, it's going to be all right. We'll tweak the comp plan, Ron, and everything will be fine.
Everything will be fine.
We just tweak the comp plan.
He talks about how consultants will tell you, oh, they understand your system better. Their system is the right, you know, the only method for understanding your enterprise. And he equates this to like a golfer buying new clubs, right? It's never the golfer. It's always the tools, right? But he did study over 2,400 management models like the McKinsey 7S, right? Strategy, structure, system, staff, style, skills, and shared values, I think it is. And he did find that there are common elements in every enterprise. And he laid them out: governance, leadership, organizational culture and climate, learning and development of employees, strategic planning, organizational structure, and control systems. And then so he kind of gave a chapter on each of those. And how it relates to the system. And that's where we can go next. Ed, I can give you some of the I'm not going to go through all seven of them, but I'll go through some of the highlights and tell the folks what he said about those points. So,
Well, it sounds good, Ron, but want to remind our listeners that they can get a hold of Ron or me by sending an email to asktsoe@verisage.com. Of course, the website is The Soul of Enterprise, where you can see show notes as well as previews to upcoming shows. Quick reminder that we'd love for you to rate this podcast, and you can do that by going to ratethispodcast.com/TSOE. But right now, a word from our sponsors and my employer, Sage.
A little birdie told me Voice America is on Twitter. Follow us at Voice America TRN.
Sage provides accountants with compliance, reporting, and analytic solutions to do more for their clients. These solutions include education programs such as the Sage Accountants Network Client Advisory Service Program. This program delivers the tools to create, package, price, market, and deliver additional services to clients, increasing your profitability and delivering more value to your clients. Let Sage help you grow your business by visiting sageaccountantsnetwork.com.
Have you ever been so annoyed by a commercial for a $5 ebook that you were willing to pay $10 to never hear it again? I sure have. Hello, I'm Greg Kite. Over the last several years, you've come to hate me, and I hate me too. By now, you know that for $5, you can get a copy of Ron and Ed's book. What you might not know is for twice that much every month for forever, you can stop hearing me plug Ron and Ed's book, which totally makes sense, like the Diamond Water Paradox. Go to patreon.com/TSOE and subscribe today. Please, for the love of God, make it stop!
The Internet's number one talk station. Number one talk station. VoiceAmerica.com.
You are tuned into The Soul of Enterprise with Ron Baker and Ed Klass. To find out more about our show, visit us on the web at thesoulofenterprise.com. You can also chat with us on Twitter using hashtag AskTSOE. Now, back to The Soul of Enterprise.
And we are back on The Soul of Enterprise talking about systems thinking made simpler. And Ron, there's some other stuff that from this book that you think is important for us to talk about. So let's jump in.
Yeah, he talks about these most common elements of your enterprise, whether they're going to emerge, whether by default or design. So governance, leadership, organizational culture, learning and development of your team, strategic planning, organizational structure and control systems. He points out that governance sets the purpose for the whole system by default or design, but often governance is the most opaque and mysterious element of the he calls it the enterprise management system overall. Mm. And he talks about governance and its impact can dwell unexamined for long periods and emerging only in a time of crisis. That's a really good point.
So how does this relate to the partnership model in CPA firms? That's where I was thinking.
Exactly. That's the ultimate cruise control, right? Mm-hmm. Until you have a confronted with some big change. It's a really good point.
So we got to make a capital call. It could be. Everything's great.
Everything's great. Yeah, don't worry about it. And then he talks about leadership is the most powerful in the system after the initial purpose of the system is set by governance. And leadership alone has the vision and authority to design and develop the system or to ignore it and let the system develop by default. And he points out the extensive writing on leadership has been offered without context afforded by systems thinking. Mm-hmm. The leaders tend not to think about it, but he suggests a leader must cultivate two critical traits, systems thinking and humility.
So I'll tell the story. This, there was a company I was working with that had this is a long, long time ago, had a performance management system that was put in place, and the performance management system, it was whatever their year end, let's call it their year end was December 31st. I don't recall that it was, and I don't think it was calendar year end, but let's just say for the purposes of this story that it was. Well, because they wanted to make sure that everybody got their year end review done and in place, they actually said that you had to do your year end conversations and go through the process starting at the end of November. But the measurements that you put in place were based on the entirety of the year. So you were trying to work within the system where we weren't quite finished the year, but we had to do the performance review anyway, as if we had done the whole year. And I said, well, why don't you just back it up? Why don't you just, have the performance year end September 30th? And then that way you can conduct the performance reviews in the fourth quarter, but have that. And they're like, no, we can't have that. It's got to be the year. I mean, okay.
This guy's, he talks about this in the feedback section because the feedback is really important in the system. And of course he talks about the difference between efficiency and effectiveness, which I love. But he talks about performance reviews are one of the most dreaded tasks in business today. But he said there's a better way, and he calls it success planning, where in advance you and your direct report have discussed together what constitutes success. Mm-hmm. And then reviewing the performance becomes much more objective and much less stressful. Especially if that's done with an AAR. So it's kind of like a bar and an AAR.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. Well, we've documented that enough to know that those are far superior to, for to sure. any performance review. Yeah.
And when he talks about culture reflects the interactions of the system, he says, if you do not complete the story for your employees, they will complete it themselves. So the kind of back to the comment, the truth will always emerge from the system. Mm-hmm. Merely writing down the values you expect will not suffice. There's a great Italian saying, the paper will not refuse the ink.
Nope. So anything on the performance review, just, you know, I always go to that Big Keith's appraisal in the British version of The Office, which was just,
yes,
absolutely hysterical. We'll put it in the show notes. It's
classic.
Yeah. Classic way to look at it.
But he also, I love this, cause you know, we try and teach after action reviews, and that's another kind of different, difficult cultural change, but that could have a massive impact on, because it affects the interactions of the people, right? Mm-hmm. And it affects learning and even teaching to some extent. But he quotes this guy, George Stoddard, and I think it was one of his mentors. And he says, we learn to do neither by thinking nor by doing. We learn to do by thinking about what we are doing. Wow.
Mm-hmm.
That's
very meta, Ron.
That's very meta. That's very, I absolutely love that. And then, of course, Peter Drucker, I can't remember this line, but Drucker said, the talk you hear about adapting to change is not only stupid, it's dangerous. The only way you can manage change is to create it. By the time you catch up to change, the competition is ahead of you.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah. That's Mr. Drucker. Drucker was really the guy who really made the point over and over that your business, no matter what it is, your organization, is an interdependent system. Mm-hmm. He kind of equated it to the human body, that you just can't optimize every organ and be healthy.
Right.
You know, sometimes you have to let an organ go or cut off a limb to optimize it overall. And it's like these firms just want to optimize every single piece and think they have a more effective whole.
And they can't. And, you know, and that leads to something that's been a bugaboo of mine. And I've been banging my spoon against my high chair for years about this, is that this, and this may be another one of those anti-systems thinking laws, right? But it's this whole notion about the system, and I've lost my train of thought, Ron. So where are we on this? continue. I'll come back to it.
Well, W. Demings said that, you know, 94-97% of the problems in business were systemic, meaning that when he saw a problem in an organization, he never blamed the person.
It was
a systems problem.
Yeah, and that's exactly what it was. Where the system ends up, or the people end up serving the system.
Right.
Rather than the system serving the people.
Right. Right.
And that's what that leads to. That optimization problem of absolutely everything directly leads to people serving systems.
Yep. And this was Drucker's point about knowledge workers. And one of the ways it was completely different from the blue collar workers of the past, or even, I guess, some extent, the agricultural workers, is in a knowledge environment, the knowledge worker is the system.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that doesn't mean that, you know, they don't have to work together and collaborate and all of that, but you know, it's a different paradigm.
Yeah.
So, you know, he finishes the book by saying life is too short to live in or be a warden to a psychic prison. He said, so build a system of shared purpose, vision, values, and commitment. Grant people clear, inspiring areas of freedom where they can grow and prosper. Very Blockian. Mm-hmm. And you'd best start believing in systems because you're in one.
What's the riff on the Yakov Smirnov old line? You know, in Russia, you know, party always finds you, or you might not be interested in politics, but politics is always interested in you.
Yeah. What was the old joke about what's great about the Stasi? What made the Stasi better than Uber? They already knew where you were going. They picked you up. Well, Ed, what do we have next week?
Ron, we are undetermined on next week's topic, so we're going to have to come up with something. In 2 weeks' time that we're going to have our interview with Brian Kaplan, economist Brian Kaplan, one of the really great, I wouldn't say young economist anymore. He was young maybe 20 years ago we first started reading him, but now he's just in there. But he is a fantastic thinker, and I really can't wait to talk to him. But next week we'll come up with something, Ron.
Excellent. Well, maybe people can write in, give us suggestions, or tweet us.
Absolutely.
Sounds great, Ed. I'll see you in 167 hours. This has been The Soul of Enterprise, Business and the Knowledge Economy, sponsored by Sage, building experiences that connect, remove friction, and deliver insights. Join us next week, folks, on Friday at noon Pacific time. In the meantime, feel free to visit us at thesoulofenterprise.com for more information on each show and upcoming shows, plus resources and books and other things that we've mentioned today. Also, you can contact me or Ed at asktsoe@verisage.com. Thanks for listening, folks. Have a great weekend.